issue. So these are the contents. We will have a brief introduction. Then we will see the historical development of MCM, data transmission using multiple carriers. Then we will see MCM with overlapping subchannels. Then we will see how to mitigate the subcarrier fading. Then discrete implementation of MCM. Then we will see OFDM. And then the challenges which MCM faces. So let's start with the introduction. MCM is a principle of transmitting data by dividing the stream into several bit streams, each of which has a much lower bit rate, and by using these substreams to moderate several carriers. And it has several advantages, like it will reduce interference, it will reduce narrowband fading and multipath effects. So the brief history of MCM, how it developed. It was initially started by military in 1950s and 1960s, and originally the concept of MCM required the use of several channels that were separated from each other by the use of steep sided filters, as they were closed space, so interference from different channels could be eliminated. And this MCM first became widely used with introduction of this broadcasting system such as DAB digital radio, DVB, which used OFDM, orthogonal frequency division multiplex. This we will look further. Then OFDM used processing power within the receiver and orthogonality between the carriers to ensure no interference was present. And other cellular systems have used multi-carrier techniques to achieve high data rates by using two or more carriers from a standard cellular system. Dual carrier HSPA is one of the examples. Now, data transmission using multiple carriers. In the figure, we can see we are fading R bits per second, and it passes through a serial to parallel converter. And first, it is mapped, and it is converted in time domain, then frequency domain. So we can see in the figure. So this is its description. Like, this was the basic form. It is the most simple form, where it divides data stream into multiple substream, and which are to be transmitted over different orthogonal subchannels centered at different subcarrier frequencies. Here, the coherence bandwidth for channel is assumed to be less than channel bandwidth. And the basic premise of multi-carrier modulation is to break this wideband system into n linearly modulated subsystems in parallel, such each with subchannel bandwidth bn is equal to b by n, and data rate rn is r by n. So data transmission using multiple carriers. The nth subsystem in linearly modulated relative to the subcarrier frequency fn and occupies passband bandwidth bn, and we can see the modulated signal associated with all signals are summed as st, which we see in the figure, and it is given by I squared summation I is equal to 0 to n minus 1 si gt cos 2 pi fit plus phi I. Now the nth substream is linearly modulated relative to subcarrier frequency fn and occupies passband bandwidth. The modulated signals associated with all the subchannels are summed together to form the transmitted signal given as st I equal to 0 to n minus 1 si gt cos 2 pi fit plus phi I. This has been repeated. Now data transmission using that was the transmitter part. This is the receiver part. Here the opposite things we are doing. What we did in transmission, in the transmission part, we are just opposite. We have to recover the signal which we have sent RBPS. So here we have demodulator parallel to serial converter. So it is just reverse. Now data transmission using multiple carriers. Here we are required bandwidth for non-overlapping subchannels is b is equal to n 1 plus beta plus epsilon tn. And this form of multi-carrier modulation is specially inefficient. To maintain the orthogonality of subcarriers at the receiver, near ideal low pass filters are required, and which are very expensive. So now we have overlapping channels. So how can we improve the spectral efficiency of multi-carrier modulation by overlapping these subchannels? And in this, the subcarriers must still be orthogonal. so that they can be separated out of the modulator in the receiver. So subcarriers are set of cos 2 pi f 0 plus I by T by n plus phi I, and this is the equation written here. Now it can be easily shown that no set of subcarriers with smaller frequency separations forms an orthogonal set on for arbitrary subcarrier phase offsets, and excess bandwidth due to time windowing will increase the subcarrier bandwidth by an additional epsilon by tn. The total system bandwidth with overlapping subchannels is given by b n plus beta plus epsilon by tn, and when n is very large, it bandwidth becomes n by tn. Thus, with large n, the impact of beta and epsilon on total system bandwidth is negligible, in contrast to the required bandwidth b is equal to n 1 plus beta plus epsilon by tn. And this we can observe all the factors in the diagram. So, and this is the diagram for overlapping channels. Now the subcarrier fading, we have to mitigate it. So and we know that MCM provides advantage that each subchannel is relatively narrow band, which mitigates the effect of delay spread. But when they express flat fading, and it can cause large BERs for some subchannels. In particular, if transmit power of subcarrier I is PI, the fading of that channel is alpha I, and received SNR is gamma I alpha square PI by N0 by BN, where BN is the bandwidth of each subchannel. If alpha I is small, then the received SNR of the I subchannel is quite low because it is square of. So this can lead to high BER. Moreover, in wireless channels, alpha I will vary over time according to a given fading distribution, resulting in same performance degradation association with flat fading for single carrier system. And to remove this flat fading, there are several techniques: coding with interleaving, overtime, frequency equalization, pre-coding, and adaptive loading, etc. Now, discrete implementation of MCM. Although MCM was invented in 1950s, the algorithm to implement them, it came 20 years later, after discrete Fourier transform, IFT, and cyclic prefix came in the picture. Then this MCM implementation started. So we can see that for each input sequence, the length n, these last mu samples are appended to the beginning of the sequence, and this yields a new sequence. So discrete, and we can see yn is equal to xn into x bar n into hn, and which can be given by, and it reduces to xn into hn. Thus, by appending a cyclic prefix to each channel input, the linear convolution associated with the channel impulse response becomes a circular convolution. And taking the DFT of the channel output yn in the absence of noise, then yields phi I is equal to xi into hi, and the input sequence xn 0 to n less than n minus 1 can be recovered from the channel output yn. And for known hn bar, we can write xn is equal to idft yi by hi is equal to idft dft yn dft hn. So the cyclic prefix serves to eliminate isi between the data blocks, since the first mu samples of the channel output affected by this ISI can be discarded without any loss relative to the original information sequence. And this cyclic prefix is just a guard band. It is a sort of guard band which we are using in FDM. Now in OFDM we are using cyclic prefix. And this is the block diagram of orthogonal frequency division multiplexing. Here we are adding the cyclic prefix, and to the and then we are finally deducting the signal. And this is the receiver part. All the inverse part, when we are recovering the signal, again we are removing that cyclic prefix and fading it to the first we are doing fast Fourier transform, then we are fitting it to the parallel to serial converter, and through QAM demodulator, we are recovering the RBPS. So this IFT yields the OFDM signal consisting of sequence xn, x0 to xn minus 1 of length n. And it is given by this expression, xn is equal to 1 by root n, 0 to n minus 1, xi e j 2 pi ni by n. And the transmitted signal is filtered by channel impulse response HT and corrupted by additive noise. So that received signal, this is our yt is equal to x tilde t into HT plus NT. And the signal is down converted to baseband and filtered to remove the high frequency components. The AD converter samples the resulting signal to obtain yn is equal to x tilde n into HN plus Vn. The prefix of yn consisting of first mu sample is then removed. This results in n time samples whose DFT in the absence of noise is yi is equal to hi xi. And the OFDM system effectively decomposes the wideband channel into a set of narrowband orthogonal subchannels with a different QAM symbol sent over each channel. They are creating a circular channel with all zero prefix, and this zero prefix reduces the transmit power related to cyclic prefix by n mu plus n n oblique mu plus n, since the prefix does not require any transmitter power. However, the noise from received tail is added back in the beginning of the symbol, which increases the noise power by n plus mu by n. Thus, the difference in SNR is not significant for the two prefixes. Now, some challenges which multi-carrier systems may face. First one is peak to average power ratio. If PAR, we are abbreviating it to PAR, it is when it is low, it allows transmit power amplifier to operate efficiently. But when it is high, it forces the amplifier to have a large back off in order to ensure linear amplification of the signal. And this is a response of a typical power amplifier. And this PAR is a continuous time signal, which is given by max of XT mod whole square by expected value of XT square. And for a discrete time signal, it is given by max of XN, XN mod XN square into expected value of XN square. Any constant amplitude signal, square wave has a PAR is equal to 0 dB. A sine wave has PAR is equal to 3 dB, since and maximum of sine square t by t is equal to 1. So PAR is given by 1 by 0.5 is equal to 2. And the second challenges in MCM is the frequency and timing offset. OFDM modulation encodes the data symbol XI onto orthogonal subchannels where orthogonality is assured by the subcarrier separation delta F is equal to 1 by Tn. The subchannels may overlap in the frequency domain as it is shown in the figure, which I will show after it. In practice, the frequency separation of the subcarriers is imperfect. So delta F is not exactly equal to 1 by Tn. So inter-carrier interference, ICI, could happen. This is generally caused by mismatched oscillators, Doppler frequency shifts, or timing synchronization errors. And these are the challenges. This is shown in the figure. Overlapping subcarriers, rectangular pulses with frequency 10 Hz and del F is equal to 1 Hz. So finally, we conclude MCM was analyzed and we saw various features and see how improvement was made from ordinary. Then we saw OFDM concept was introduced, the cyclic prefix was added and how to recover it. And the challenges were seen. And the multi-carrier modulation techniques are widely used for data transmission as it is able to provide an effective signal waveform which is spectrally efficient and resilient to the real-world environment. And I have taken all the material from wireless communications of Andrea Goldsmith. Thank you.